பேனர் தெரியுதுல்ல? அனைவருக்கும் மாலை வணக்கம். இன்றைய மைண்ட் யுவர் மைண்ட் வித் ஸ்டீஃபன் நாம தொடர்ந்து தி ஐகான் ஸ்டீவ் ஜாப்ஸ் பத்தி பார்க்க போறோம். Maria is going to present the fourth part, chapter, fourth part of the icon. I welcome everyone this evening to have Mario's the next session of the speech. The session is being handed over to Mario. Please proceed.
Thank you, Ankit. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. So this week we're going to talk about the third chapter of the book Icon, which is based on Steve Jobs. So the last 2 weeks we saw the early life of Steve Jobs and how the company started. So now we're going to get into a phase how the company grew and, you know, the successful stories that the successful story that was Apple in the 1980s. So in the beginning of 1979, Dan Fritzler was a software entrepreneur. Steve handed an Apple II computer in the early stages to him in the hope of him designing a software that could help everyone. So Dan brought a software back that would be called as VisiCalc. It was the first type of spreadsheet where it could calculate numbers, the average, the sum, multiply and divide. So it was the first spreadsheet, and it was only added to the Apple II computer. And once it was only custom for the Apple II computer, the sales of the Apple II computer increased, and it dominated. It was the dominator in the PC market at that time. So in the next year, the sales doubled again. So in 1980, the Apple II sales doubled again, and it was a great sign of Apple growing. Despite this, he was not happy because it was Apple II was his machine. He wanted to be known as the creator of a machine. So what he wanted to do was, he wanted to be not only the genius, he wanted to be a genius of the company, and it was not only Woz that was a genius behind the computer. So he had a new machine in mind, and he named it Lisa. Lisa after his daughter's name. And it was supposed to be a $2,000 system that would be based on a 16-bit architecture in the early stages. So Steve hired two engineers from HP for the design. Meanwhile, Steve convinced Steven Birnbaum from Xerox Corporation. Xerox Corporation had earlier invested in Apple, $1 million in Apple. And he convinced Steven Birnbaum of Xerox to visit Xerox Park. Xerox Park was considered the holy grail of computer research at that time. So when Steve, Bill Atkinson, and another couple of Apple employees went to the computer research center at Xerox, they were amazed at the technology that was there. They had it was the first signs of a mouse being used. So they, at Xerox, they were moving a cursor across the screen to touch a application. But until then, you know, all computers were used by commands, by either entering numbers or and that displayed number or alphabet. And this was the first sign of, you know, the mouse. And he was amazed with the technology. He had even asked, why are we not using it? So after their visit to Xerox PARC, on the way back, Steve asked Bill Atkinson, how long would it take for you to deliver this at Apple or deliver this with Lisa? So Bill Atkinson said it would probably take 6 months, but he was totally wrong. It eventually took 5 years to get completed. And the cost of the Lisa computer was projected to be $2,000, but eventually it became $10,000. And Steve, as we all know, was very famous for his statement. The first statement that he made for the Lisa project was, we'll make it so important that it will make a dent in the universe. So it was, he was known for his statements and very famous lines, and this was one of the early lines. So moving on. At the same time, Mike, Marcella, and Scotty were, along with a few managers, wanted to design a new structure at Apple, because Apple was already growing. They were about 1,000 employees at that time, and they designed a structure without informing Steve Jobs. And there were three divisions. One was the accessories division, second was the PC division, and the third was the professional office systems division with a flagship product as Lisa. Instead of putting Steve Jobs in charge, the responsibility was handed over to John Kuch, who was the vice president of software. So the plan of the management was a slap in the face for Steve Jobs, and he was expecting to become the vice president of new product research at that time. So, but did not receive it. And to soften the blow, what they did gave the position of the chairman of the board. And the reason why they told him that they gave him the position of the chairman was the upcoming IPO, where the Apple stock was going to be traded publicly. And the reason is they wanted a young person to represent the company as the chairman of the board, which would hike the stock price. This was a clever move from Marcola and Scott, but it wasn't too good for Steve Jobs, who was unhappy at that moment. So the second week of December 1980, on Monday, in that week, ex-Beatle John Lennon. John Lennon was a very famous singer and was an ex-Beatle gang, Beatle member. Beatles was one of the very famous music groups back in the 50s and 60s. And John Lennon had passed away on Monday. And on Friday, Apple computer stock was traded for the first time publicly. And Apple Computer's 4.6 million public shares were sold within an hour. And this was the most successful public stock offering in history up to that time. So that was the first sign. And the second was, it was the most oversubscribed IPO since Ford back in the 50s. Ford Motor Company. So the early private investors did really well. For example, Xerox invested $1 million, and soon after IPO, the value of that $1 million worth of stock was $30 million. So they made 30 times their money in less than 5 years, or less than 2 to 3 years. And to this day, Steve Birnbaum of Xerox said, to this day, I'm still impressed with how two very young men with no college degree, with no money or experience, went on to build a Fortune 500 company in less than 5 years. So that was a very famous statement of Stephen Bernerbaum of Xerox. So Steve Jobs supposedly said, when I was, this was a very famous line of Steve Jobs. He said, when I was 23, I had a net worth of $1 million. When I was 24, I had a net worth of $10 million. And when I was 25, I had a net worth of $100 million. And because of the IPO, Steve's net worth had increased more than $100 million. And at this time, he was not only was he super rich, but to the public, he was considered as an icon. So this was the first start of Steve Jobs' public figure. But what happened at the same time was Steve Jobs denied to give stock options to his peers, one of whom was Bill Fernandez, who was the first employee at Apple, and soon later he left the organization because of this. But eventually he returned. Chris Espinosa, Randy Wiginton, and Steve's friend Dan Kotke also did not receive any benefits out of the IPO. They were the first employees, and one of them said, we worked the donkey hours at the early stages of building the company together, but we did not receive any stock. And this was the first time of Steve also being, in his own way. He wanted to have everything for himself. So as the holiday season in 1980 arrived, Steve felt unsettled because he had just signed his child support papers, but had not made any effort to visit his daughter since the childbirth. And his role in office, he was a chairman, but he had no direct control in the Lisa project because it was handed to another person. And he was a chairman without a portfolio. So he was unhappy about that. And then at that moment, while he was unhappy, he found in the R&D phase of Apple that there was a computer being built by Jeff Reskin. The computer being designed by Jeff Reskin was a small, inexpensive computer that he had planned to build for the masses, where every person can have a computer at their home. That was Jeff Reskin's idea. And the name of the computer was Macintosh. Macintosh was Jeff Reskin's idea. And he named it Macintosh after his favorite type of apparel called Macintosh. So his vision for the machine was for it to be portable and to be less than $1,000, which means that Apple had to build it within $300. In that year, the Macintosh was in and out of the main project because of Lisa as the main project. But Scotty kept the project alive without Steve knowing. So after being rejected from this Lisa project and his money from the IPO, Steve wanted to find something to do, and he was intrigued by the concept of Jeff Reskin's idea that building a computer for everyone. So Reskin's team was inspired that Steve, who was the chairman of the board, was alone, but they considered it as a double-edged sword, where if things go wrong, it's going to be them. If things go well, it'll be Steve's. It'll be because of Steve. So that was their idea. And Steve looked at the new design of the Macintosh, and he was convinced that it's going to be the Apple II of the 80s. He was so convinced that this is going to be the next big product that Apple is going to release. So Steve made it clear to Reskin that he will be part of the project, and they had many arguments. Reskin and Steve did not get along too well. So Reskin made his complaints to Scotty, and Scotty and Mark Fuller planned, to have Steve involved in the Macintosh project, and they can, handle the rest of the company. So they wanted Steve to move aside to the Macintosh product and let them handle the rest of the company. So what happened? Raskin tried getting support from Scott, but he got sandwiched between all of them. So Steve, who was a master of unrealistic goals, set a timeline that Macintosh would be ready in a year. But at that moment, they only had hardware. They only had basic hardware. There was no operating system. There was no application, just a few demos. So yet Steve had a magical power of persuasion. Soon the team believed that the timeline can be achieved. So Jeff Raskin and Steve were not getting along too well. And at that time, Steve Wozniak suffered a major air accident. So at that time, what happened was Steve Wozniak was in a private plane. And that time, while taking off, they met with an accident. And when he gained consciousness in the hospital, he could not remember anything about the incident for the next 5 weeks. So that had happened. Steve was trying to take full control of the Macintosh project from Raskin. Hence, Raskin wrote a memo to Scotty complaining about Steve, saying that, in the past, his optimistic estimates were wrong, and he will be wrong on the Macintosh as well. So what happened? When Mark Fuller returned from his trip from Hawaii, they arranged for a meeting between Jobs and Raskin. And at the meeting, Steve Jobs cried as usual. And at the end of the meeting, he still, he was in control of the Macintosh project. Raskin left humbly, and he took a vacation just to, forget about the incident. So if the world was, just and right, Jeff Raskin would be known as the inventor or the genie behind the Macintosh. But the computer that was imagined was totally different from the computer that came out. And the true father of the Mac was Jeff Raskin. True father of the Mac to the world was Steve Jobs, its adoptive father. So the initial idea was by Jeff Raskin, but Steve Jobs manipulated it, made changes, and brought the project out. So eventually he brought the project out. We're going to see how he did that. So by the end of 1981, Apple was already a four-year-old, swollen company with a lot of people, and Scotty, along with Steve Jobs accepted the proposal of firing people, of sending people out, and many incompetent heads and departments were removed from Apple. But what happened was Steve very cleverly moved away from the incident, and the company came to know that Scotty was behind the firing of people. So by February of that year, Wolf had been released from the hospital, but it wasn't clear whether he'll be returning to Apple. It wasn't clear whether he'll be returning to work. And the closest thing to a mad scientist, in terms of mad scientist means, at that time, a computer genius was called as a mad scientist. And the closest thing to Wolf was Bill Atkinson, who was a programmer who would not stop until a solution is found for the problem that he had. So he was very famous for solving problems and finding solutions. And he will never give up until he gets the solution. So at one particular incident, one particular occasion, while he was working all night on the project Lisa, while returning home after staying the night and early in the morning while returning home, Bill Atkinson met with an accident. a car accident. And Steve Jobs visited him in the hospital and asked him later on, are you okay? And this convinced Atkinson to join Steve in the Macintosh project, which is a very big, which is a very good sign for the Macintosh project. So Steve did not waver from his deadline, and he was known to be a micromanager to the nth degree. Nth degree meaning he was into every detail of the Macintosh project. He wanted to know everything that was happening in the project. And on one particular day, in a design meeting, he went in, took a phone book, similar to a Yellow Pages book now. He took a phone book, he put it on the table, and he said, I don't want the Macintosh computer to be bigger than this. It should be this size, nothing larger. And up till that time, no computer was even close to the size of the phone book. It was twice as large as the phone book. So that was a very hard task that was given. But he convinced the people again that it can be done. And he wanted to do it. So soon after Scotty was firing people, slowly people started against him. And it soon reached the human resources department. And after Mark Fuller came back, he visited, he arranged for a meeting, Sunday meeting with Scotty, and told him that the executive board wanted his resignation. So Scotty was out and Mark Fuller was the interim president. Still determined to complete the Mac project, Steve put a bet of $5,000 with him, Lisa, product manager, and that created a very big frenzy between both the projects. So Lisa project members wanted to complete the project first, and the Macintosh project wanted to complete the project first. So it became as a race, and I think that's one of the good ways of competitiveness that can be seen. So in terms of software, Steve knew that, you know, Apple was not ready for software, and he started looking outside. So when he thought of the word young and software, the only person that came to his mind was Bill Gates. Bill Gates at the time was designing a software called Basic Programming Language. And he invited them over to Apple. He invited Bill Gates and Paul Allen, who were the founders of Microsoft at that time, to visit Apple and their new computer. So when Bill Gates and Paul Allen visited Apple and they saw the new project on Macintosh, they were excited because this was a new project for them. And up till that time, they were only designing dull software. Dull software meaning they did not go beyond the terms of IBM. IBM was using a basic programming language, but Steve wanted something very, very different. And Bill Gates and Paul Allen were so thrilled to join and build the software for them. So the following month, IBM introduced its new computer, new version of their personal computer. And as everyone expected at the Mac team, it was large and clunky. It was large, but they were building a small computer, And at that time, Apple released an ad, very famous ad. They stated, welcome IBM, seriously. That was a question mark. And that ad got the media attention. So it was a very direct ad to a company that was 10 times larger than Apple. So by July, the Mac project was beginning to look ready. And the price of the Mac 1 would be $1,500, including software, and falling to $1,000 to Mac 2. Steve, out of thin air, said the Mac would achieve first year sale of 5 lakh units. And soon everyone started accepting the fact that it can be done because he persuaded everyone to believe in his idea. Steve convinced Mark Fuller that the Macintosh was a serious product because up till that time, Lisa was only considered the main project. And in So Steve had to accept to push the date to October 1, 1982 because the Mac project was not ready. And in February of 1982, Steve took his Mac team to their first retreat. And in that time, one of his famous lines, the team was called, "The journey is the reward." So if we look back at these lines, I think it is all Steve that, you know, started these lines. These lines are famous now, but it was initially Steve who brought them up. So the journey is the reward. And by early 1982, the team was filled with many computer engineers. Steve was not only super rich, but he was getting a salary of $2,50,000 per year. But he did not allow any of his engineers to receive more than $30,000 per year. So this was one of his crazy demands from his team. But every one of the engineers continued working at Apple for the only reason was that they were on a revolution of personal computers, and that was thrilling to them. And at the same time, Steve was considered by the public to be a great innovator. And what happened was, Steve Wozniak returned to college, which made Steve Jobs the only person, you know, be as a genius behind Apple. So at the same time, Steve was single, and he met a singer called Joanne Benn, who was 41 years old actually at the time, and she was around 25. So he told Bill Atkinson that he had feelings of wanting a family, but you know, she was too old for him to settle down. So the Macintosh team, you know, showed up for the second retreat, and the team was nearly 100 people. And this time the slogan was called "Let's Be Pirates." The third chapter of the book, Icon, is also titled "Let's Be Pirates." And the other line from Steve Jobs was, "Working 90 hours a week and loving it." He put this quote to his team, directly pointing them to work 90 hours per week. So meanwhile, in the fall of 1982, the Lisa project was preparing for release. And at that time, the journalists came in for an early look, and they were also amazed at the product that was ready. So what happened? At the same time, Apple II sales were also moving way ahead, and Steve was in the midst of his infatuation with Joanne Baird. On the same time, what happened was, Apple did not still have a candidate for presidency. Steve Jobs thought he was competent enough to be the president, but none of the board members thought he was suitable for the president role. So at the time, Steve, in January of 1983, he was insulted by the Times magazine, stating that he was lonely, and he was rich, powerful, but lonely. And they put a picture of him sitting alone in his house. And later he came to know that it was behind the prank of the magazine. But as we all know, Steve just ignored the criticism and moved on. And on May 16, 1983, another tough day, the Mac was not ready for this day, but the delay turned out to be a great thing, because Steve wanted Lisa to be released first before the Mac. So what had happened this time was, the reason why Steve wanted Lisa to be released before Mac was, Lisa, he knew that it was very costly, but the Mac was going to be inexpensive and have the same features of the Lisa computer. So the third Mac retreat was held in a motel because of the current situation. And Bill Atkinson, who was the chief software architect, was furious because he was not given any credit on the product, on the product Lisa. So he was about to leave the organization when Steve knew how important Bill was. He gathered everyone and said that the Macintosh name was finalized, because at that time what happened was, the Macintosh name, they had Apple had a battle with Macintosh Labs because of the same name. And what happened was Steve offered Bill a significant raise in his salary, a good pile of stock options, and the freedom to work on anything because he knew how important Bill was to the company. So in early 1983, Steve moved to an apartment in Manhattan and convinced John Scully. John Scully, who was the current, who was the president of Pepsi at that time, he convinced John Scully to join Apple. And one of the very famous lines in US business, he said, he asked John Scully, "Are you going to sell sugar water for the rest of your life when you can, when you could be doing something very important?" So this line is very, is one of the very famous lines of how he convinced people. And thinking of it, it actually, you know, is a very thoughtful quote, very sarcastic, but very thoughtful, thoughtful question. So Scully joined Apple with a $1 million salary and other benefits. And he said, if you can pick one reason why Scully joined Apple, he said it was a chance to work with Steve. And Steve was one of, was considered one of the great innovators of that century, of the century. And he had a chance to help him grow. So Wall Street approved the appointment of John Scully, and the stock price of Apple rose to $63. But what happened at the same time, soon after that, the Lisa was not selling too well because it was $10,000 and IBM was $3,000. So IBM was the dominant computer at that time. So the company reported, the Apple reported their first loss in the last quarter, and the stock price fell from $63 to $21. So the Mac project was also near completion. And on Sunday, January 8th, 1984, the programming team only had 1 week left to complete their part of the project. And during a phone call, they were going to tell Steve that they cannot do it. But Steve, out of very, you know, a very different tone, he said, he told them that Apple considered them great people and were counting on them. And he said that it, they could make it happen. This was unexpected from the team because they know, they were thinking that they're going to get blasted by Steve. But they went to work the whole week without sleeping, almost without sleeping. And on time, they were able to deliver the programming software. So in, I'm just, the session is about to end. I'm just going to share the last few points. So in January 1984, Super Bowl ad in the US, they have very famous football leagues and baseball leagues. So in one of the ads, it's called a Super Bowl ad. In one of the ads, they designed a beautiful ad, which turned out to be one of the early stages of how marketing, you know, could really inspire people to change, to make a change. So in their ad, they showed they showed men sitting in benches wearing prison-like uniform, gray prison-like uniform, and looking at a big screen, teaching them something. And there suddenly ran a very young, attractive blonde woman who ran across wearing a red dress, ran across and broke the screen on the stage. What they tried to do with this ad was they wanted to show that Apple was different, and people who think, you know, they can do different things can beat the can beat everyone else. So after the ad, the Super Bowl ad, a lot of television channels promoted the ad. And it was $3 million worth of advertisement for Apple. And what at the end of the ad, it was on January 24, 1984, we're going to release the Macintosh computer. Apple is going to release the Macintosh computer. And you'll understand why 1984 won't be like 1984. That was their voiceover behind the ad. So as expected, they deliver the ad, they deliver the Macintosh on January 24, 1984, and Steve presented the Mac in a very different way. So he took a paper bag on stage and he took the Mac computer out of the paper bag. And the Mac computer, there was a prototype voiceover which said, "Hello, I am Macintosh. It is sure to be great out of the bag. Unaccustomed as to I am to public speaking, I like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met a IBM frame, mainframe." So it took a direct hit at the IBM PC. And what Macintosh, the voiceover said was, "Never trust a computer that you can't lift. And obviously I can talk, but right now I like to sit back and listen to you. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce the man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs." So this was a voiceover from, you know, the first computer that spoke back to people. And it was taken out of a bag from Steve Jobs' hand. So until up to that time, computers were so huge and clunky and big. This was the start of the revolution of the personal computer that we have now. And as the presentation was over, by the end of the month, they had 70,000 orders in 1 month. And at last, they even considered Steve's numbers of 5 lakh units in a year to be considerably a good estimate. So this was the whole story behind the Macintosh computer and the third chapter. And I'm just going to share the key insights and points that I would like to share with you that we could all learn from this. So the first thing, what I really admire from Steve is, if we have a real desire, if we want something in life, it can be achieved no matter the circumstances that we go through. And the second thing is, anything is possible. A lot of people, what I've noticed in India, a lot of people have ideas. A lot of people I've connected with have ideas, but they don't have the capital to get started. And that is one of the main reasons why great entrepreneurs with, you know, people with great ideas never get going in India, because, you know, the lack of funds. But this is an inspiration to show us that you don't require a college degree, you don't require money, or you don't require experience. You require a persistent desire and a vision to build a big company. I think there are people in India, there are people amongst us who have ideas, but we just lack the persistent desire to achieve it. We lack the drive to achieve it. So I think when the major reason why, you know, most of us fail at businesses, or why most people fail at businesses, we stop at the first sign of failure and we don't really plan off how we're going to get ahead of the failure. So I think it's very important for us to be inspired by this and begin thinking, how can we, you know, improve our lives? And if we have some great idea or vision, it is possible. So the third thing, also what I've noticed is, there will be a lot of people who are going to say no to you. There will be a lot of people who are going to criticize you. There will be a lot of people who will say your ideas are not going to work. But if you firmly believe in something, and if you go all out for it, it can be done. That's the key part of, you know, Steve Jobs' life. So the last thing is, last couple of things is, first, we can learn from anyone and every situation. There was a very famous quote that I remember. We are never too old to learn and never too young to teach. So always be open to conversations. Always be open to people. Never ignore a conversation, because you will always find something valuable, even not at the current moment, but it could be later on. And that's one thing. And I think if we take time into investing also, we'll be able to make a lot of money. The reason why I tell this is, I know it's a very difficult topic to talk about investments, but for example, Apple, when we hear the price of $21 or $63, the current Apple share price is about $1,000. So people who back in the 80s, if they were able to invest in Apple, they'll have close to 500 times profit. I'm not saying, you know, it is possible every single occasion that we invest. But if we do find some great company, we can do that. Another example, since I'm, you know, from banking and I understand investments a little more, there was another example that we came across. In 2002 or 2004, instead of purchasing a Royal Enfield Bullet bike, if we had to invest the same money in their shares of that company called Isha Motors. Isha Motors is the company behind Royal Enfield. But we all, a lot of people think Royal Enfield is a company, but Royal Enfield is a brand and Isha Motors is the company behind it. So if we had to invest $50,000 that time, it will be worth, I would say, close to a crore in 2019-20. So, but if imagine if we bought a bike in 2002 or 2004, we'll not have the bike now anyway. So just think about this, do a lot of research. If you really find some company that you think is worth investing, you can go ahead and do that. Okay. Thank you, Ankur. Thank you, everyone. If you have any questions, you can please let me know.
Your conclusion is wonderful. Yeah, really is so nice. Madam, you want to say a few words?
So beautifully, yes, narrated the history. Actually, I was not aware of Steve Jobs as he has spoken now in detail. Really, he has spoken and he touched the nuances of the marketing technology also by stating the advertisements and other things. And apart from that, as you said, the crowning glory is actually his conclusion. Really, it was very nicely for his age. He has brought all the points which has to be mentioned and he has nicely described, sir. Kudos.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, madam. Sir, you want to say a few words? Anything, sir? Mike, unmute, please, sir. Just unmute and talk, yeah.
Okay. Fantastic show. I learned a lot of things. As he said, from everyone and every situation, you can learn. He said in the middle
of the day. I believe in that.
Okay. Very nice. Lot of points. At 23rd age, one million. 24th, 10 million. 25th, 100 million.
That is a very famous line.
Yeah. Then, ஒரு இண்டஸ்ட்ரியுடைய ஓனரா இருக்கிறதுக்கும் அதுல ஒரு எம்ப்ளாயியா இருக்கிறதுக்கும் எவ்வளவு வித்தியாசம் இருக்குங்கிறத, அதாவது அவரு நல்லா வந்துட்டு இருக்க போது ஓட வேண்டியது இருக்கு, ஒரு ஆப்ஷன்ஸ் கொடுக்கல. யூ செட் தேர் வேர் சம் மேனிபுலேஷன்ஸ் பை ஸ்டீவ். இஸ் இட் நேரேட்டட் இன் த புக் ஆர் யூ கேதர்?
Mostly in the book only, sir. Yeah. I have not taken any content from outside.
Okay.
Manipulations, meaning he did not let his friends or other members, you know, get stock options, get stock from
the company. Yeah.
But I don't know why. Maybe early stages, Steve was like that. So later on, maybe he
transformed. For startups, it's hard to share the hard-earned money.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah. A lot of points I noted. He made everyone to believe in him. That's a valid point. Good way of competitiveness is challenge. Two units, both of them are his only. He made them compete each other. It's very nice. then why the employee worked there for the thrilling of the job? If anyone finds a thrilling, money doesn't matter for the thrilling. He has shown them the thrilling. That's nice, nice point. His question, are you sell sugar water for your entire life? Or I didn't note down here.
Are you going to do something really important? Or are you going to work on something really important? So really important, what you meant was the revolution of personal computer.
Correct. Stock options only, Leon. Like as our friends said, the concluding part is wonderful. That bike, purchasing a bike and purchasing the share. Very nice. That is becoming a owner. That's the important thing. Very nice. Well covered. All our appreciations to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mario. Actually, see, I touched the computer during 1985. Actually, I learned basic during that time. But I just heard about Apple. I didn't know. See, I always think that Apple and Macintosh are the same boat. But I came to know the complete story of the Macintosh. Now, see, this is the lesson I learned now, really. And then, the graphical-oriented OS. See, earlier it was IBM. IBM, they only had typing program only.
You'll have to enter commands.
We never had that graphical-oriented. The Apple, they made it graphical-oriented. See, these are the things where we challenged. They challenged those days. And now, see, the unique market for them.
It's a very unique market.
Unique market, and they achieved large.
They're one of the they're the most valuable company, actually, on the planet.
They started in a great top in the worldwide markets.
They have $200 billion on them. They have $200 billion in cash reserve.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not knowing what to do. They are working. Even what I came to know was they are working on an electric car now.
There are a lot of conversions. Of course, really. I feel very happy to have you. Expecting more from more lessons from next week. How long it will go?
I'll try to cut it short to half an hour. I think, you know, this session took a little long
It's not an issue. Don't cut it short. Go as long as much possible for you. Okay.
Okay.
That is not an issue. Okay. So we are ready to hear.
four concluding sentences are also very nice. Real desire. It can be achieved. Anything can be achieved. A lot of people have ideas, but lack of funds. Not people to say no to everything. He faced an accident. He was conscious. He had no conscious for 5 days. Then also he came back. You beautifully put it, coming out of failures, lot of all the four principles you derived from the third chapter are wonderful, nice, great.
Thank you.
Criticisms. And if you are strong in your faith and your principle, really great, sir. He has brought everything in a nutshell and he has presented it.
Yeah, of course.
Very nice.
The leadership quality, how to manage the criticism. That is the main thing. And taking
desire. those things correctly presented, sir.
Yeah, taking responsibility and creating a trust. These are all the qualities of the real leader.
Actually. A very good leader.
Good. Thank you. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Uncle. Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. We'll see you next week. Thank you.